guest today in Top Styles is Eche Mwamwadi, all the way in Area 49. I'm so excited to have him today in our episode. It's been a long time coming. I want to get to know who he is, how he started Eche Mwamwadi Inc., and where he's going with his journey. First and foremost, thank you so much for allowing us to come here today.
Welcome, and thank you for having me.
Thank you. Please just tell me a brief background of who Eche Mwamwadi is as a person.
Eche Mwamwadi, as a person, by name, it's Robert Mwamwadi. So I am the last born of seven. I am of the Yao tribe, so that means I am Malawian. I'm Christian, I'm a Presbyterian. And I am a holder of a Bachelor of Education in Science, and married. Yeah, so pretty much that's that.
You don't want your wife saying, oh.
No.
Interesting. Okay,
sure.
Just tell me how you started jmwamwadi.inc. How did that start? Because you have just said you did education, and how did you end up in the fashion industry?
Yeah, well, having spent 5 years at Chancellor College, well, graduated in 2013, started on the journey of job hunting.
Okay.
And I think Malawi isn't, jobs aren't that easy to come by. So we could get some jobs, and then there was a time when I was unemployed, and then I got tired, I think, of searching for jobs. And then I was like, okay, with the knowledge I have and the expertise I have, why can't I just be an employer? Why can't I, you know, do my own thing? So interestingly, I had gone to Tanzania, where I bought a few stuffs, clothes, embroidery clothes, and then I brought them back. I tried to sell, and then I realized that there was a lot of demand. And then an idea came into thought to say, okay, I can't always go to Tanzania to get this stuff. Why can't I, since these are tailored things, why can't I just make them here? So that was the genesis of Eche Mwamwadi. I did my research, and then I found out that even here, we have got people that are capable of making clothes. So did a few samples. Surprisingly enough, the demand was equally high.
Mm.
And then that was the genesis.
Okay, that's a very nice story. Yeah. I should say, when in terms of, you're talking about the expertise that you had, that's the education part that you did. But in terms of maybe designing, is this something that you have already had interested in, or is something that you started learning in the process of, let me also start building this business?
You know, by far, I would not have thought I'm going to end up into the designing industry. I think way back in secondary school, I always envisioned myself as a doctor.
Yeah.
And then I envisioned myself as a lawyer. But then, you know, life has got its own way of, you know, directing you towards a particular path.
Yeah.
But I've always had an interest in clothes, you know, dressing up and, you know. So this for me was something that I feel I could be passionate about, because if you're to do business, you should do something that you're passionate about.
Mm.
That way your interest is going to be steady.
Mm.
You know, so I never really thought I'd be into fashion, but then at the end of the day, I saw the opportunity, I saw the demand.
Mm.
I was like, okay, why not?
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to get the exact part where you used to draw, then you hired someone, or you learned also how to use the machines?
I had to learn in the course of the business. From the beginning, it was primarily just using other people. But now with technology coming in, you've got YouTube, most of the stuff was self-taught.
Mm.
So I had to learn some of the things online. I could do the tutorials, I could do the cutting. And then I had one particular a tailor that I'd employed who said, no, boss, I think it would be best if you also, you know, get to sew, and you also get to cut and do all that.
Mm.
So by and by, during our free time, he also started teaching me. And then also when I had gone to Tanzania, I met some Congolese guy there who also had trained me for at least two weeks, and then shed more light on some of the things. And then when I got back, then I just carried on from there. Yeah, so the learning has been through the journey.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. So that's the start of Eche Mwamwadi. You look nice, by the way.
Oh,
is
thank
this
you.
Are
so
you wearing
you.
Your own brand?
No, I'm not wearing my own brand. Unfortunately not, because this material, we'll get to talk about that, but then this material we can't find here.
Yeah.
Yes.
Speaking of material, here we are talking about material.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me what sort of materials you work with.
Usually I work with the Ankara fabrics, the chitenges,
yeah.
And then we also work with linen, cotton, But then I think most of these are they're imported. Yeah, so we work with pretty much every kind of material.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Where do you normally get your material? Because I think I've heard a couple of designers talking about it's so hard to get material in Malawi.
It is good quality
material.
Yeah, it is.
So how do you go about that to make sure that you're giving your clients great material?
Over the last few years, I have mostly been sourcing them locally here. So we have got, I think, the local market, the free market where we get them. We call it as Kwazimaya Zambia,
yeah.
You know, so that's where you get all these fabrics from Zambia. And then we've got the Taifas that stock these materials from Tanzania.
Mm-hmm.
But over the years, through experience, you get to talk to one or two people, make connections. And it's only of late that I've managed to get a partner who also sends fabrics from Kenya. Mm-hmm. And another one also, she imports them from Dubai and I get from her. Yeah.
Speaking of something that you started doing because you saw that there's a gap in the market and also you saw that you want to create employment for people, tell me what inspires you to continue doing such a business and also just to give a good quality clothes to your clients.
No, I think the inspiration came as a result of my own journey, you know, because I was like, okay, here I am, having spent 5 good years in the university, and then it takes me about a year or two before acquiring a job. And then I had to put other people into the perspective to say, okay, if someone who has got a degree cannot easily get a job, how much more someone who maybe did up to their JCE or MSCE. So I thought it would be best if we don't just depend on the government, if we don't just depend on our academic acquisitions, but rather we become job creators. So that drive was, okay, if I can't get employed, why can't I employ others? Because I can equally help others, equally help families to do the same. So I think it was that passion and that need to help others that inspired me to be where I am today and to continue pushing towards that.
How long has this baby of yours been?
Well, it started in 2015. But then officially for people to get recognition, I think it was early 2016, because that's when I started doing my first runway in 2016. So I could say Chimamadi has been into existence for close to 5 years now.
Tell me the experience that you had during your first runway. I must think it was very overwhelming.
It was overwhelming, but it was challenging actually, considering you've got all these competitors, you've got all these people that by then had already made their name, and then you are just a novice, like, okay, how am I going to perform? Am I going to give up to their expectations? So it was really challenging, but I could say that at the end of the day, it was also a learning experience. So I learned from the first showcase that I had. The comments were good. I think that is also what pushed me to continue doing until you know, 2018, that I did my second runway, of which I emerged a winner.
Oh.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I was promised talk of sponsorship. I was promised that I would be sent to Brazil. I'm still waiting for the ticket for Brazil.
I want to know the first runway. What was it called? And the second one that you actually won. Just tell us a bit more about that.
The second one, I think it was just organized by some entertainment house here in Lilongwe. So we were about 5 designers. Yeah, I think I still have the photos from that runway. So it was here at the stadium, at the Bingo National Stadium. That's where we did the lead lounge. That's where we had the fashion show. Yeah, but then yeah, it was good. It was good. It's just that I think at the end of the day, there are still some other things that the organizers are yet to fulfill. So I wouldn't talk much about that one.
Okay.
Until I think it was 2019, I had my third runway. I happened to have consulted for Beautify Malawi. So I did a fashion show for the first lady at BICC, and then that one was a success. And then in 2020, I also organized another fashion show at the Game Complex for Beautify Malawi as well. So I think that one was particularly targeted towards awareness and on stigma that you know, it was called More Than a Mother.
Okay.
More Than a Mother project, where we're using fashion to communicate to people that women are not just instruments of childbearing. One can be married and not have a child, and sometimes it could not only be the woman that has got a problem, men could have problems too. So basically I could say that there have been just shows, but then there have also been shows that are campaigns. Yeah, so I've worked with such kind of clients before.
Okay.
Yeah.
You have mentioned that you have done a couple of runways and you are still doing. If you were to count, how many runways have you done so far?
I think there would be six.
Six.
Yeah, but then the last three are the ones that I would consider to be major, because the other ones were minor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to know the relationship between Jay Mwamwadi Inc. and the models that you pick. Do you have a certain type that you pick to showcase your clothes or any sort of models are okay with you?
No, all models are okay, but then I do have a preference towards, because most agencies will only showcase maybe slender models, but then I try to incorporate all. I will have child models, like maybe kids. I'll have the small size models. I'll have the plus size models. I'll have male models, female models. Yeah, so I work with all kinds of models as long as they are up to the task and they are professional and they know what they are doing. So, yeah.
I want to talk about some of the designs that you have back here.
Yeah.
And as you can see, ladies and gentlemen, we have some of the Jay Mwamwadi designs here. Just tell me some of the fabric that you worked here. I'm seeing this suit has more of Ankara also. Is this also Ankara?
Yeah, that's Chitenge, yes. That's Ankara, yes.
Okay, tell me a bit more about the designs that you have right behind.
So some of the designs are more or less inspired towards the Buy Malawi concept, where on Fridays, maybe civil servants and also other people are supposed to wear clothes with an African touch. So I was, for example, this design here, I was conceptualizing a suit, but then that is in Chitenge as opposed to the normal cotton. That is plain. So I was like, okay, why don't we make something? It's an office wear, but then it's also Chitenge. And then the other design is the concept rise behind the modern boom in Chilundu.
Yeah, I think this is quite famous in the year 2020.
Over 2020, it's been almost every wedding, every function, you find women, you know, traditionally wearing the Chilundu and whatnot. And then I was like, okay, what if we could have a Chilundu version for a male Chilundu version? So that's the fabric that most women use for Chilundu. I was like, okay, why don't I use it to also do a male version of the same?
Okay.
Yeah, so pretty much sometimes I'll just do clothes out of the blues, but sometimes I'll follow trends. Okay, what is it that is going on now? And then also at the end of the day, like this one, our clients are of different income levels, you know. So I try to do clothes that anyone can afford.
Yeah.
So I'll do clothes that, you know, the low income earner would get, and then I also do clothes that maybe a high end earner would also afford. So at the end of the day, I try to incorporate everyone.
Okay. Seeing that you have been in the industry for quite a few years now, tell me some of the problems that you have faced as a designer and as well as an employer as well.
I think the greatest challenge, I will refer back to the showcase that I had won. Oftentimes we as designers and as employers, we invest our time, we invest our money into these whole runways.
Yeah.
People get excited. No, this event, you know, we're having this showcase, call for designers. At the end of the day, we spend money in expectation of a particular return. And then when it so happens that the organizers do not live up to their promises, it becomes very frustrating. It's very discouraging for one to also go into the next show, because be like, okay, you know what, I will just spend money for nothing.
Yeah.
And then also I've noticed that there's a lot of patronage. Patronage is good. People will go and patronize events, but then there's not many sales, you know? Because the organizers will go showcase a design in the hope of getting clients in the hope of getting maybe orders and demands at the end of the day. So people just go take pictures, oh wow, wow, it ends there. And then you'll have like, oh wow, I've spent all this much money for nothing. So that more or less like backtracks. So I think I myself have been more cautious over the last year, especially 2020. I haven't really been into a lot of runways and fashion shows because I thought, well, it would just be an expenditure and then nothing in return. I'd rather just concentrate on making clothes that if somebody buys, I've got something. So I think the greatest challenge is sponsorship and also the sponsors living up to their promises. And then the second challenge, I think, is the textile. Yeah, if we could have a big company that would produce textile locally, it would mean that now the fabrics would become cheaper on the on the market. And if we can get cheaper fabrics, it means the profit margin will increase. And then also people are going to be able to afford the clothes because the pricing also go down. But then because we get the fabrics expensively, we also end up, you know, pricing our clothes high, and that affects business. So that could be one of the challenges. As an employer, the greatest challenge, I think, is getting someone that you can actually trust. This business is tricky because it's not every time that you have to be there present in your office. You've got other things to do, you know. So to get an employee that is trustworthy, someone that whether you are there or not will still be able to do a good job, and maybe they'll be accountable of the money and the demands, the things that they've done, you know, I think that's the tricky part. So usually people say that tailors are not stable. Yeah. Today they are here, tomorrow they are there, the next day they are there. So I think the greatest challenge has been to secure experienced tailors that will actually stay and they'll actually be loyal and, you know, they'll do a good job.
I was just reminded me about a joke about tailors.
Yeah.
We'll hear it later.
That's okay. The joke. All right. Okay.
Moving forward, how many maybe employees have you, in the years, been able to help, been able to, you know, to just fund as an employer yourself?
Yeah.
We'll talk of entrepreneurship, you talk of being an employer. Maybe currently, how many workers do you have?
Presently, I have two main tailors and I have one intern.
Okay.
Yeah, because that's also one thing that I do. But then because of the limited space, I cannot get a lot of interns at the end of the day. But then I hope in the near future when we get a bigger space, because I usually get requests from schools, from students, no, Chimamadi, we know of your brand, we know what you do, would like to come for internship. And then at the end of the day, I'm like, okay, this space, if I'm to have 10 students.
Yeah.
So as of now, I've got two main employers, I've got two tailors, I've got one intern, I've got a secretary, and I have got three carpenters.
Okay.
Yeah, because due to the COVID impact, clothes have not really been, you know, going. So I had to divert into home decor.
Okay.
Yeah, so I also started carpentry.
Interesting. It seems I love to just go around and just to see what other things that are in your shop and some of the things that you're working on.
Okay.
And we were outside. We saw that some of the sofa sets that you are fixing as well. And Let's check out how
I think
the studio looks.
That'll be good.
Like.
That'll be fun. So let's move around.
Amazing.
Okay.
All right. So this is the suit you're showing me that's made from African prints.
Yes.
But this doesn't look like it. You'd think it's another.
Yeah, you'd think it's a different fabric altogether. You think it's the Frollo type.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So I think at the end of the day, fabric choice is also key towards marketing, because if something is nice and appealing, then you'd have a lot of people wanting it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the jacket looks like you can wear it inside out.
If I was to take this fabric all the way in, it would be a double turner. But in this case, I wanted a kind of concept where, for example, I've got a different set of pants that are in this color. So you could use one jacket for two sets of pants.
Okay.
So that way it's like you have got two suits. So you have two pants and one jacket that will suffice for two.
Mm.
So when you change, you'll be like, okay, it's a different suit.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so
basically, that's that.
That's interesting. You do have people coming here for custom-made clothes as well.
Yeah, we do have have, yes, people, actually most of the clothes are custom made.
Okay.
Because people have got different body sizes, different types, so there's a beauty in custom made clothes. For example, as you can see, this is our model, Kelly Jones. Okay, so she's one of our models that works here with
Hi, Kelly.
Us.
Hello.
So as you can see, she's nicely dressed. So yeah. As a client, suppose Kelly is our client,
yeah.
But then she wanted this suit. So custom made clothes, they have to be a proper fit.
Yes.
You see? So in this case, for example, when a client comes, we have to check to say, okay, is the bust okay? Is the length okay? So we tend to make adjustments where necessary,
okay.
So that the client can then be happy at the end of the day on the fitting that they wanted.
Okay. Yeah. What sort of clients do you normally get? Weddings?
Weddings, engagements, in courseways. We also have basically maybe civil servants for their day-to-day wear.
Okay.
Yeah. So pretty much Chemamadi is open to all sorts of clients.
All right.
Sure.
This is nice. So if you were to call this suit, what would you call it? Made by Chemamadi?
I'll just say Che.
Che.
She's wearing Che.
Che. I like that.
Yeah, she's wearing Che.
Okay.
So that's the beauty about the custom made. If a client comes, we'll get to measure them. They get to try the clothes on, and then we make adjustments. Unlike clothes maybe that are imported.
Mm.
You import something from China, it comes here, maybe it's big or it's short, you know, there's nothing you can do about it.
Okay.
But now at least with custom made clothes, there's a beauty in that you can keep adjusting it until you are happy and satisfied.
Okay.
With it.
So you're spoken about people buying clothes and then coming to you to adjust them. How do you deal with such clients? Do you just tell them you can't do it?
No, we accept such clients considering we know that it's not that if they come with an adjustment today, it's not like that's the only thing they're going to do.
Yeah.
Tomorrow they might come with a new cloth that they need something done. So we don't turn them away. We will still accept them, we'll do the work for them, and then hoping that tomorrow they'll bring us a different business altogether.
Yeah.
So
this is the one you said is resembling the Chilundu.
Yeah, Chilundu. So if you would notice, there are some women that also like to wear, you've heard of the boyfriend jeans, there's these women that also like to wear their boyfriend jackets. So this is a kind of concept where I'm trying to envision a lady that wants to wear a manly thing, you know, maybe
a manly chilundu.
Even though, yeah, people say, well, clothes are
unisex,
but then at the end of the day, suppose the boyfriend wears this, and then she wants to, you know, wear the boyfriend's shirt. She would wear this and some jeans
and
on the bottom, and then she still look good. Or maybe the lady's wearing a chilundu in this color, and then the man will be like, you know what, I still want to match, okay? So, you know, that's the question people say, what do you do to get to that level where you get matching outfits?
Yeah.
So suppose you want to do matching outfits, one would wear a chilundu, and then the man could wear something.
I think you should
like
also
this.
Get into styling. You seem to be doing very well with colors.
Am I?
And just suiting everything together.
Well, I think on that case, I'll have to style you on the next show.
Definitely. I'd love that.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
So in terms of, a lot of clients maybe worry that there are some designers that are a bit slow in delivering work.
Delivery, yeah.
Yeah. How is your performance in terms of delivery?
Well, at Chemamadi, like I've said, that we do have adequate stuff. We use electric machines. So I would say, but at the end of the day, I think it all comes down to planning. You know, you need to plan your work. Should be able to plan your work.
I want to get to know this material.
This material is what a lot of people, most men, are preferring and liking right now. It's called Lucas. It's cotton. It's called Lucas. So most of the people prefer this.
That?
Yeah, it's ironable. You can iron it with a dry iron. You can iron with a steam iron as well.
Okay.
Yeah. But then some prefer the glow. But the beauty of this fabric is that you can even turn it inside out. So you can use the outside that is shiny.
Yeah.
And then you can also use the inside, which is a bit dull.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Yeah, but then over time, of course, the shine
goes away.
Yes, yes. So
depends
on how many times you're washing and wearing it. Yeah.
So you mix that with the
chitenge. So like in this case, one would choose to have the pants in the chitenge, or you'd want the pants in the the Lucas, the black.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
And again, you can wear this as a dress.
You can also wear this as
like leggings.
With leggings
pants.
As it is, because usually, as you can see, it's longer.
Yeah.
So maybe you're home. You're not going anywhere. You just feel like being comfortable.
Yeah.
You can just wear something like this, mm-hmm. you know, in your home, and then you just put on your leggings, or you say no, Chamamade, I want mine to be longer because I don't want to wear anything on the inside. So it means we simply have to bring it all the way down here, and then you can be comfortable in your home.
Even a male can wear this.
Even a male can wear this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Sure. So pretty much, we do according to what the client wants.
All right.
You say, I will not dictate unless you ask me to help you in the styling.
Mm.
But then we prefer a client comes and then they tell us exactly what they want, and then we do according to what they
okay.
want. Sure.
All right. Thank you so much, Chamamade, for allowing us to come and just to view what Chamamade.ink is all about. Maybe lastly, what should we be expecting from your brand this
I think, as you can see, Kelly here is a really beautiful model. She's good at what she does. But then I would want to make a difference in the modeling industry, in the sense that maybe I could have an agency that is actually, that could do things differently.
Okay.
You know, because I have an issue. I get to talk to models. I get to see how their life is going, and then the benefits they're getting in the modeling. Well, there's not much. So I would have loved to, I intend to have a modeling agency where maybe models like Kelly here can, you know, actually earn a living out of modeling and not just being asked to do things for free.
So
I think that's what people should be looking at.
Okay.
A modeling agency, but also maybe more products coming. As I said, I like to, you know, diversify. So we might say, no, Chamamade is launching another product or going into this direction. We hope that Malawi and the world at large will support us as the voice down. Sure.
Thank you so much.
No,
this has been so lovely. I've had fun.
It has been.
Okay.
Sure.
Ladies and gentlemen, that has been Che Mwamwadi on our episode of Top Stars Today. I'll call him Jack of All Trades. Very exciting. He has told us the brands that he's been working on. He has been in a couple of runways, and he's actually trying to build in different districts in the country as well as outside the country. And has talked about so many other things as well. Not only does he deal with clothes, he also just makes sure that he's revamping. Maybe if you have an old sofa, you can take it to Chamamade. He's going to revamp it for you. He wants to get into agency, modeling agency as well. He does curtains. Again, like I said, jack of all trades. Very exciting. And I'm so excited to actually had a conversation with him to see where his brand is going in Malawi. Thank you so much. Until next time, my name is Priscilla Kaira. Goodbye.
Zira mainitsi ATNM kuyambira 200 kwacha kapena kuposela pamenepo mutha ukhala mmodzi mwa mamilionea mu TNM Tikolole promotion.